اللهم لك الحمد حمدا نستلذ به ذكرا وإن كنت لا أحصي ثناء ولا شكرا لك الحمد حمدا يملأ الأرض والبر والبحر لك الحمد حمدا مقرونا بشكرك دائما لك الحمد في الأولى ولك الحمد في الأخرى والصلاة والسلام على رسوله محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين وبعض قال الله تبارك وتعالى في كتابه الكريم والفرقان الحميد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم كتاب أنزلناه إليك مبارك ليدبروا آياته وليذكر أولو الألباب صدق الله العظيم Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, the translation of the verse, that this is the blessed book. The Quran is a blessed book that we have revealed to you, O Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The people with understanding, the people with sound mind, may reflect over its verses, the signs of the Quran, and those with understanding, with sound mind, derive lessons from it. So my respected brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. The topic, inshallah, that I'm going to talk about today is called the secrets of Suratul Kahf. So you know, every businessman looks for opportunities where he can advertise and you know promote his business. So I said, this is my best time to talk about Suratul Kahf when everyone is here and present. They have no time limits to go back to work and so on and so forth. Alhamdulillah, it is really a good Friday. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. So, Alhamdulillah, you know, our everyday life, you know, that we're living, Alhamdulillah, we heard lectures, we heard so many things that, you know, it is really good to read Suratul Kahf on Fridays. And there's so many ahadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that example, Abu Sa'id al-Khudri radiallahu anhu narrates, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, more or less to the meaning, the person who reads the 10 verses from the beginning or memorizes it or the last 10 verses of Suratul Kahf is that person will receive the light, a divine light that will be from himself all the way to the Kaaba. Also not only that, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said more or less to the meaning that a person who recites the Suratul Kaaba, same hadith, is that the person that from one Friday to the next, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive his sins and also that the light will illuminate until the next Friday. So Alhamdulillah, we should try to keep in recitation of the Suratul Kahf. So just to give you a little insight of Suratul Kahf, what it talks about and why is it important to read. And we know we talk about Dajjal and all the stuff that goes on, the Antichrist. But how is Suratul Kahf related with Antichrist? And how is Suratul Kahf related to our lives? So when you look at these things, and then after that, inshallah, we'll talk about, you know, the survival kit, how to survive in this world, and all this fitness and facade that is going in the world, how to survive ourselves. So this is my the topic today. So we wonder why that we read Suratul Kahf. That's the first topic that we're going to do, that how is Suratul Kahf is important for us. So that's the last look at today. So Suratul Kahf has four stories. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down the Quran is not to tell us stories. Like Yusuf alayhi salam, the whole story, mashallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala beautifully described. But it's not to read this, you know, the stories in the Quran, but actually to take out the morals from it and implement those things into our life. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions four stories. So let's look at the first one. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the beginning verses of Suratul Kahf, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the people of the cave. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِذْ أَوَى الْفِتْيَةُ إِلَى الْكَهْفِ فَقَالُوا رَبَّنَا آتِنَا مِنْ لَدُنْكَ رَحْمَةً وَهَيِّئْ لَنَا مِنْ أَمْرِنَا رَشَدًا فَضَرَبْنَا عَلَىٰ آذَانِهِمْ فِي الْكَهْفِ سِنِينَ عَدَدًا The whole story Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions of Suratul Kahf, the people of the cave. So there were some youngsters, I'm just going to go briefly to it so you understand what is the thing, the story behind it. So there were some youngsters who actually believed in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but there were some cruel king at that time who were disbeliever. So the town was the disbelieving town. So these youngsters, because of the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they migrated from there and left the city. Now, one point that derives from this is that the reason we should migrate is not because of the wealth to gain so many things, but one very important that we can find is that when we migrate from one city to another, one country to another, we should only have the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the main cause, the main fundamental of immigrating. Now, so these people, they went to the cave, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, with His rahmah, with His blessing, made them sleep. And also not only that, even in the sun, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala turned away because they entered in the morning. And by the time when they were woken up, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was in the evening. So these people, they were inside, even the sun used to reflect, but not on the body. So according to Ma'arif al-Quran, the tafsir of it, Shaykh Uthmani rahmatullah alayhi mentions the reason why it didn't fall onto their body, because of the heat, they wanted to preserve the body and also the things that they were wearing. So this is another miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And when they came out from the cave, and because it was the evening, so someone said, hey, how long do we sleep for? So some say probably some part of the day, some part of the night, or a little portion of the little bit we stayed inside, because when it came out it was evening. And then one of them says, Wallahu Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. So this is the, and then after when they came out, they saw the villagers were all believers. So this is the story of the first person. Now what is the moral behind it? The moral is that the trial of faith. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests them that really the faith that they have, that how much yaqeen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that was the trial of faith. The second story that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about is the owners of the garden. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, وضرب لهم مثلا رجلين جعلنا لأحدهما جنتين من أعناب وحففناهما بنخل وجعلنا بينهما زرعا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, it talks about the beauty of the person. The person he had, he used to own two beautiful gardens. And because he sowed the garden, he plowed the garden, he made all the effort that a person needs for a garden to grow and flourish. He made all his effort, because of which he had a two beautiful garden. But he forgot that the blessing of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's not you and I who does the effort and it just comes out. But actually Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tested that person. So because that person, what happened, he forgot to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala of his blessings. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he went to such an extent that he didn't, you know, he forgot that one day we have to pass away and there's life after that. So he didn't even believe all those stuff. So this person, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him so much, but he neglected, he forgot to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what happened? A wrath from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala came and destroyed the gardens. And after that he regret, he did tawbah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it was no avail, everything was gone. So in this story, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives the trial of wealth. So the first story was about faith, the second is about wealth. The third one is a very famous one that we know, Musa and Khidr alayhi salatu wasalam. So the story goes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِذْ قَالَ مُوسَى لِفَتَاهُ لَا أَبْرَحُ حَتَّى أَبْلُغَ مَجْمَعَ الْبَحْرَيْنِ أَوْ أَمْضِيَ حُقُبًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala paints the picture of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. So when Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was giving a talk to his people, Bani Israel, and he was standing, he was about to give a talk, so someone asked him from the group, he says, who is the most knowledgeable person who exists on the earth right now? So Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, because he was a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he receives his miracles, he receives his wahi from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so he says, according to his status, what he said is true. He says, yes, I am the most knowledgeable. But according to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he did not like the tone, the way that Musa alayhi salatu wasalam said. This is the one way that how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala actually brings the Prophet close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and then reprimands them, because they want to be in the highest position and the highest level of faith. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reprimanded Musa alayhi salatu wasalam, says, no, Musa, he revealed. He says, no, there is another person who's better than you. He says, go, take this, he goes, oh Allah, where can I meet him? Where is my appointed time? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that take a fish in a basket and then go until the fish becomes absent. You know, it becomes ghaib, and then you will find that that will be the place. So obviously he put a fish in the basket and he was traveling. Obviously, common sense, that fish was in the basket or will die without water. So as he was going, and then what happened was he was tired day and night. They're walking with Yusha ibn Nun, was the name of the person who was traveling with Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. They were tired, they're putting their head on the rock and they fell asleep. When they woke up, as a miracle of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the fish became alive and started moving and jumped into the ocean. And then so on and so forth, they traveled day and night and found Khidr alayhi salatu wasalam, and then the story goes on. So in this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the moral of the story is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the trial of knowledge, that no one is more knowledgeable than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The fourth story that we know is known as Dhul Qarnayn. Now the word Dhul Qarnayn, meaning possessor of two horns, who has horn, but he doesn't have a horn. Also that scholars say that because he used to rule from one side of the world to the other, or some scholars say that he had two locks that he had was curly on both sides of his head. There's so many narration, but wallahu alam, Allah knows best. But so Dhul Qarnayn alayhi salatu wasalam, he was a very great king. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَسْأَلُونَكَ عَنْ ذِي الْقَرْنَيْنِ قُلْ سَأَلْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ مِنْهُ ذِكْرًا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions his surah, the story of Dhul Qarnayn in this. And then he said he was a very powerful king. He used to go and he used to go around the world, and wherever he sees oppression, wherever he sees dhulm going on in the world, he used to go and subdue those things and help the people that were has been done dhul upon. So all these people that he used to go and help around. This is the quality of Dhul Qarnayn alayhi salatu wasalam. And then also that he came to a nation, and then where he subdued, overcame Ya'juj and Ma'juj, Gog Magog, and build a massive dam, this Ghadam, Asad, and then help the people and overcome and so on and so forth. So in this, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave, was that the trial of power. So these are the four things that is mentioned in the Quran. Now, in between all the surahs, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the main person that does all this, you know, who comes into trial and tribulation and fitness, shaitan. So it's mentioned in between those, that indeed in the middle, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned Iblis. He is the one actually who, you know, stirs up these trials. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, behold, he said to angels, bow down to Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. فَسَجَدَ الْمَلَائِكَةُ كُلُّهُمْ أَجْمَعِينَ إِلَّا إِبْلِيسِ. That everyone bowed down except Iblis. And then what happened? That he was one of the jinns. He was one of the jinns, and he broke the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, will you take him, his progeny, as a protector rather than me, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And they are enemies to you. Even evil would be the exchange of the wrongdoers. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about this. Now let us see the relationship between Surah Al-Kahf and Dajjal. What are the four qualities, the four signs of Dajjal? Now when you heard the four stories that mentions regarding the four type of trials, now look at the relation between Dajjal. When Dajjal comes, he will have four signs. First of all, is that he will ask, when before Dajjal comes, before the Day of Judgment, with four trials. One was that he will ask the people to worship him, but not Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test your trial of faith, as the beginning of the story. And I just want to sidetrack. A companion asked Ali radiallahu anhu, Ya Ali, what is the difference between a adab, a punishment, and the difference between a trial, a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Very, listen carefully this. Allah subhanahu, Ali radiallahu anhu says, if the trial or the fitna that is come upon the community or whatever, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us, if it does not remind you or does not take you to closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then you know that is azab, a punishment from Allah. But a same thing that happens, But it takes you close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, reminds you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No, that is a test from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my respected brothers and elders, we should always be trying to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala everything that we do. Even we forgot something, we do something, we get hurt, we should always say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajun. Comes in the hadith, more or less to the meaning, even though you put a pocket somewhere, you put your phone or pen somewhere, you're looking for it, you forgot, and you put your hand and looking for it, even though you say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajun, Allah gives you so much reward that you wish you were saying, Inna lillahi all your life. This is the blessing of the Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajun. If you forget anything, something happens to you, always say, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi rajun. So the second one is that He will give the power, the start and the stopper of rain. So many things that will come. People will, you know, His wealth, temptation of wealth. So this will be the trial of wealth. The third is that He will try the people of knowledge. He will tell him, this is where your parents were, this is where they died, and then He's going to make shaitan do everything, all the knowledge that the people are going to give them to them. That will be the trial of knowledge. And He will control huge parts of the earth. You know, the people will follow them, the mountains of gold and silver, everything will follow them, so He will have control over the earth. So that's a trial of power as well. So these are the four categories that the Dajjal will come. That's why it is important that we read these surahs and then look at the explanation, the morals, and put it into practice. Now, how to survive from this thing? So there's a survival kit. You know, everywhere you go, you find a survival kit. Without this, you cannot survive. So obviously, there's something wrong. You have a survival, first aid kit kind of thing. So I have 6 points. The 6 items that should be in the survival kit if you want to survive to the next world, and Allah will be pleased with you. First one is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَاصْبِرْ نَفْسَكَ مَعَ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ مِنْ غَدَاتِ وَلَعَشِيٍّ يُرِيدُونَ وَجْهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the end of the verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, it talks about good companionship, that the friends that we have, the people that we hang around, what kind of people are they? Do they remind you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So this is the loose translation of the verse. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in verse number 28, make sure it talks about good companionship. Second, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَضْرِبْ لَهُمْ مَثَلَ الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا كَمَاءٍ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ فَاخْتَلَطَ بِهِ نَبَاتُ الْأَرْضِ فَأَصْبَحَ حَشِيمًا تَذْرُوهُ الرِّيَاحُ وَكَانَ اللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ مُقْتَدِرًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this verse, it talks about the knowing the truth of the world. My respected brothers and elders, this is a very short life. The main thing is that is the hereafter. That's why a poet, beautiful poet, I want to share this with you, that life is a thing that runs on wheels. Life is a thing that runs on wheels. Death is a thing that everyone feels. But if a life was a thing that money could buy, the rich would live, the poor would die. But Allah's will made it so the rich and the poor together will go. This is what the real effective of life is. Life doesn't matter how rich or how poor, everyone has to depart this world. So my respected brothers and elders, this is what the reality of life is. That what we see, the blooming, all the joy, bling, that they say, right? Right? So that's all this thing that we have. But wallahi, as soon as we die, we don't take nothing with us. This is the reality of this life. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives an example of this in the verse. On the verse number 45, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that it's like a rain when it comes into the field, the vegetation. And then when it absorbs the rain, after that it becomes dry like twigs. This is what the reality of this world is. So next one, the third kit. So the first one was that good companionship that reminds you of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The second is that knowing the truth of this world, because you can depart, you will depart from this world. The third is that the humbleness. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, be humble to yourself. Do not be arrogant. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the thing, قَالَ سَتَجِدُنِي إِن شَاءَ اللَّهُ صَابِرًا وَلَا أَعْصِي لَكَ أَمْرًا. Here Musa alayhi salatu wa salam said, you will find me with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala patient, nor shall I disobey any orders from you, O Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. See how patient and humble he was with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the fourth is that everything we do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ يُوحَى إِلَيَّ أَنَّمَا إِلَهُكُمْ إِلَهٌ وَاحِدٌ فَمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُو لِقَاءَ رَبِّهِ فَلْيَعْمَلْ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا وَلَا يُشْرِكْ بِعِبَادَةِ رَبِّهِ أَحَدًا. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, everything we do, it talks about sincerity. This is the main topic here. The sincerity, you do everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why it says that I'm a man like yourself. And it is revealed to me that for you, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is one. So the tawheed, everything that you do it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And number five is that, not only that, after you become humble, after you do everything for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't forget you're doing it for yourself, but don't forget your Muslim brother. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَاتْلُ مَا أُوحِيَ إِلَيْكَ مِنْ كِتَابِ رَبِّكَ لَا مُبَدِّلَ لِكَلِمَاتِهِ وَلَنْ تَجِدَ مِنْ دُونِهِ مُلْتَحَدًا.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually inviting. Tilawa also means to invite, means to teach as well, as you also recite as well. So all this thing, when it comes, so when you recite it, don't forget to teach others. So calling people towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So all these things. And the last and final is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, verse number 46 all the way to 49. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminds us. He says,
يَوْمَ نُسَيِّرُ الْجِبَالِ وَتَرَى الْأَرْضَ بَارِزًا وَحَشَرْنَاهُمْ فَلَمْ نُغَادِرْ مِنْهُمْ أَحَدًا.
All the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا يَظْلِمُ رَبُّكَ أَحَدًا. So all these verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is actually talks about the remembering the hereafter, that this is the end of life. Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi said beautifully, he paints the picture that what is death? Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi says that it's like a person running into the jungle. Running in the jungle, a lion is chasing him, and when he goes to serve himself, he jumps into a well. Now when he jumps into the well, he's holding onto the rope. Now what happened was, as he was holding onto the rope and he sees a beehive. And then he looks down, he sees a python open his mouth. And what happened was, as he was hanging into the rope, two mice jumps into on the rope and start nibbling. One is a black color and one is a white color. Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi gave a beautiful parallel that what is this life, what is death? He says that the lion that was chasing that person is the death that's chasing everyone. And the well that we jumped into and holding into the rope is our lifeline, is our life. And the python that is at the bottom at the pit, the open his mouth, that's our grave. And the mouse that jumped onto the rope was that the day and night that is passing our life away, nibbling our life. And then what happened was that person was hanging and he saw the beehive. He said, oh my God, I'm here. And it looks nice, the honey. So he puts his finger inside and then he starts tasting and he forgot about the lion. He forgot about the mouse. He forgot about the python because the sweetness of the honey. What happened? He forgot everything. So the Imam Ghazali rahmatullah alayhi says that honey is this world. So don't forget about the hereafter. So these are the six survival kits that we should have into our life. Inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will be happy with us. And inshallah, we'll be ready to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the Day of Judgment. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the tawfiq to make it easy for us to read Suratul Kahf every day. Inshallah, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also give me the tawfiq as well to read Suratul Kahf every day. Wa akhiru dawana, alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.